Sometimes even the bad days are good. And this is the case right here. It wasn't really a bad day until at some point. I just suddenly felt like, wow. Life is terrible. There's nothing to do. I'm not interested in anything. What can I do? So I kind of like, boom, hit this really bad flat spot. Probably tired. I walked for an hour today. First time I've done that in a long time. As it's hot. The mosquitoes are out. They're bugging me right now. But I felt really despondent. Like, you know, I just want to leave the world. I just want to leave the world. I don't have anyone to hang out with. I don't have any money. I don't have anyone to hang out with. I just don't have anything to do. It's always been the case. So I'm just tired of that. So I hit a real flat spot. But I was buoyed early in the morning by some, you know, comments, some great comments on some of the recent videos. And which is great. Thank you very much. So that was all helpful. And one of the comments had to do with spaciousness. And it's interesting because I've been focusing on spaciousness the last week, and it's arising in my mind again. I remember several years ago, I remember the breakthroughs, the great breakthroughs that I had was when I decided to emphasize spaciousness as primary over objects. That's what led to the vision of oneness, peace of God, the vision of oneness. The essential breakthroughs came from that decision, and I remembered it. I remembered it. It's like Buddha trying meditational trances and physical asceticism, and then not working, and he's like, wow, I don't know what works. And then suddenly, just before he died from starving himself, he suddenly remembers when he was young by some rose bush or some kind of flowering bush. When he was a young boy, he was playing there, and he suddenly was aware of the answer, you know, for all of us. And he had forgotten it, and he suddenly remembered. And it's like, ah, that's it, of course. And the rest is a blessing for us. So I suddenly remembered, oh yeah, spaciousness, spaciousness, spaciousness. Can I get back to that? I mean, how did I do that in the first place? I mean, what happened? Do I have the will to do it? But certainly at one point several years ago, I had the will, the desperation to really put spaciousness as primary. It made just all the difference. It was a miracle. And I've kind of been trying to absorb that ever since. I said, what happened? What did I do? Why was that so effective? It's amazing. So that's been on my mind, and then I'm really despondent today. And then this idea came to me, and I've never heard of this idea before, ever. Never read about it, never come across it. It's just like brand new. I'm just, I was sitting there thinking, I don't have anyone to hang out with. I can't seem to. And nothing, we're thinking, we're planning like going to the mountains and scenic places. And I have no interest in the world, like scenic places, Grand Canyon, you know, you name it, whatever. I have no interest. I have no interest of going anywhere or doing anything. What's the use? Right? Already been there, done that kind of thing, you know, natural beauty. It's not the answer. So I'm thinking, you know, why just keep repeating the same old stuff that doesn't work? I'm still feel like an orphan, friendless, socially speaking. But there are friends around the world that are helping out. I'm noticing this, that we're helping one another. So this comment about spaciousness came up, and somehow my mind kind of said, huh, I need to pay attention to this. And so I'm sitting there at a desk, nothing to do. I don't know what to do. I don't have anything to do. Nothing interests me. And then an idea came in my mind and said, why don't I make spaciousness my friend? Why don't I befriend spaciousness? And I said, well, that would be kind of cool because wherever I go, I'd always have my friend with me, wouldn't I? I'd never be friendless again. If I can make a friend with if I can make friends with spaciousness, how can I ever be abandoned or alone? Where are we without space? Is there anywhere we can go where spaciousness isn't there? Intrinsic spaciousness? I don't mean just atmospheric spaciousness, like, you know, which ends at a wall, but I mean the spaciousness where atmosphere also appears as an object within that. But we can initially think about it as if, you know, the spaciousness of the atmosphere, there's a tree over there, house over there, but what's also present? Isn't spaciousness also present? Isn't that the number one presence that is always present with us, is spaciousness? How come we're overlooking that? How come we're not friends with spaciousness? So these questions started arising in my mind and considerations. I said, hey, it would be quite handy to have spaciousness as a friend, wouldn't it? You'd always be, if spaciousness was your best friend, you'd always be with spaciousness. Doesn't matter what objects there are. Spaciousness is like, it's still with you, isn't it? It's here right now, isn't it? When are we separated from spaciousness? How can we be separated from spaciousness? So if spaciousness is our friend, how can we be separated from spaciousness? But when we identify with bodies, we're looking for other bodies to be friends with, right? And I realized that. I said, hey, wait a minute. I've been trying to make friends with the refrigerator, the tree, the house, the people, the dogs, the cats, the cars, the roads. You know, these are all objects. How come I haven't been trying to make friends with spaciousness? Because I guess if we identify with bodies, we keep thinking that we're an object and friends, birds of a feather flock together. We need to make friends with other objects, but other objects keep dying. I've got all these friends that are, not friends, but acquaintances that are dying right now. And you know, it's hard, it's difficult. You know, if you have money, you can travel a lot, but if you don't, what can you do? I mean, it's difficult to have friends, and you might meet with them once a week or every several weeks or a month or something. You see them occasionally. The rest of the time, you're sitting in a room alone. Where's your friend? And then you turn the television, and you think that you're interacting with friends. You go to Facebook, you think you're interacting with friends. I keep getting texts from Facebook that I don't want. It says, so-and-so updated their status because I'm out of Facebook. It's like, how, you know, is that my friend? A text says somebody updated their status. I'm supposed to go to Facebook and say, oh, gee, someone updated their status, new cover photo. Gee, that makes me feel so happy. So it's like, why am I seeking friendship in objects that die, that pass away, that change their mind? Does spaciousness change its mind? Does it somehow disappear on us? I don't know. Does it get angry at us? I don't know. But it certainly seems to be always present, doesn't it? So I just felt like that would be a really cool thing to do, is to make friends with spaciousness. Hello, cat. A cat just suddenly appeared out of nowhere. But now it's off. You see, I thought a friend, my cat, oh, maybe he's going to be a friend with me. No, it went on down the road just like that. So I feel sad. Oh, there's a friend. No, it's gone. But when does spaciousness come and go, like friends do, like the friends we have in the world, people? Does spaciousness come and go? Did it just arrive? Can it arrive like the cat and then go on down the road and disappear on us? I don't know, I'm just asking these questions for the first time. But I've never heard someone say, why don't you make friends? Let spaciousness be your friend. Make friends with spaciousness. Just like a friend. It's always some esoteric, you know, this and this and that. And I was reading Buddha Mind, and it's, you know, got very, very philosophically esoteric. And I'm like, oh man, can I ever understand this? It's so, and it just came to me, wait a minute. Why don't I just make friends with spaciousness and call that good? Yeah. I don't have to wade through all this obtuse philosophical fine point speculations of you know, it just, I'm tired of that. I need a friend. I need a friend. I don't need to understand this book. I need a friend. Can I make spaciousness my friend? That's just a question I have. Is that possible? I don't know. Why shouldn't it be possible? What's the quality of spaciousness? What kind of friendship would we have? I don't know. I'm asking spaciousness to be friends with me. I'll find out. Find out. We try to be friends with food, you know, but that gets us fat and gives us problems and all that. But I wonder what it'd be like to be friends with spaciousness. Would that give us problems? Drama? Blackmail, extortion, guilt, all this human drama stuff. Would spaciousness do that? I don't know. Why would spaciousness do that? I don't know. Maybe it would be a beautiful friend. So I just, you know, I'm floating this idea out there. Can we be friends with spaciousness? Can we be friends with spaciousness? Might as well try. I got nothing to lose. I've never hung out with anyone, really, in my life. I've never had friends. Because it seems like I always felt like that's not really going to make me happy at all. And I never, you know, people, being around people never makes me happy. Being around things, I'm never happy. I've never been happy with objects and trying to be friends with objects. And never, never, never been happy. So I always said, you know, this just isn't it. This isn't it. So why waste time with what's not it? Let's see if we can find how we can be happy. Someone told me he's going to a wedding this weekend, and he says that, you know, the bride, she's on her third husband already. She's just going through them real quickly. Boom, boom, boom. He says, well, this one, maybe hopefully it's a little better. Maybe she's found something. But he wasn't very happy about it. It's like, do we find, you know, do we find what we're looking for in bodies? People? Why has no one ever even mentioned, like, why don't you try being friends with spaciousness? Just let's be friends with spaciousness. Well, why has that never been mentioned, really? You know, yogas talk about stuff like spaciousness, but they never say just be friends with it. Buddies, you know. Hey, spaciousness is my friend. and actually have a conscious relationship with spaciousness. So is it possible in that way? You know, we're always here, we're supposed to, you know, kill the ego and be in this state and do this and this and this. I said, hey, wait a minute, you know, can't we just simply be friends? Just like right now? I mean, do I have to do something first for spaciousness? I mean, how do you be a friend of spaciousness? Are you supposed to like utter some mantra or something? I don't know if that, you know, there's some initiation. Like, how do I get into spaciousness? How do I greet spaciousness? I mean, is it somewhere to be greeted? It seems to be everywhere. We might ask ourselves, how can we not have a relationship with spaciousness? How can we not be friends with spaciousness? That might be the better question. Zero calories. I like this. Zero calorie vitamin water. They've done a heck of a job with this. Stevia leaf extract. It's way better than most stevia drinks, I'll tell you that, and zero calories with a lot of vitamins in it. Magnesium lactate, calcium lactate, potassium phosphate, electrolyte sources, B3, B5, B6. How much percentage? 100% of niacin, B12, 100% vitamin C, 100% B6, 100% pantothenic acid, 100% magnesium. Wow. Well, sugar less than 1 gram, calories zero. Well, that's a heck of a drink right there. 99 cents. So, I mean, you're getting like a tremendous source of B vitamins and C from this with zero calories. Wow. I'm into this now. It's somehow they've improved their formula with stevia. It's not perfect, but it's passable. And there isn't that feeling like you're consuming sugar, calories, which is great. So we have a nice refreshing drink with lots of vitamins in it, vitamin water. I need that because that walk was brisk. I walked very briskly for 1 hour, 120 steps a minute. Striding, you know, really striding, really, really pressing it. And wow, that was, I feel it, but it's good. It's good to be able to do that. I'm really focusing on walking right now. It's kind of fun to walk. You kind of cruise underneath the trees, you look at the sky, you look at everything, and you just, but what are we not looking at as we're walking? What are we not looking at? We're not looking at spaciousness. We overlook it. We're looking at for objects, but can't we see spaciousness too as like an object also? As a presence, isn't it there? How often do we appreciate the actual spaciousness? I'm looking at leaves as I'm walking, shrubbery, and but the ubiquitousness is the spaciousness everywhere, right? We don't have a relationship with spaciousness. How is that possible? You don't go out and say, oh, I'm going to take a walk. Where are you? Well, I'm going to go out and walk and just take a look at spaciousness. Well, you can do that anywhere, they'd say. What good is that? I mean, but you're in a special place. Look at the buildings. Go walk around the city, sightseeing. Look at the skyscrapers, you know. They always point you to objects. They say, if you said, I just want to go look at spaciousness, they'd say, that's commonplace. I mean, that's nothing to look at. You gotta look at something special. So are we not trained to not see spaciousness? Isn't our conditioning raise us up to not appreciate spaciousness? Don't we get into object fixation? They said, "What are you looking at?" "I'm just looking at spaciousness." What do you mean? What are you looking at? What kind of things are you looking at? "I don't know. Nothing in particular." Well, what? You know, I mean, how about that? That tree over there, the grass. What's the name of that grass? Well, you know, and so they start teaching to label stuff and name it, which is more object fixation. They seem to get very nervous if you just, you know, I'm just staring at space. I'm just enjoying spaciousness. It's so beautiful. People, everybody, your teachers, your parents, everyone gets very nervous. They say, "Something wrong with you. You're not fixating on objects. Maybe you're mentally retarded." Is it possible that our conditioning here, we come into this world and we're overwhelmed by this object fixation? By everybody here? The kids they say, "Mom says, you see that tree over there? What's the name of that? What's the name of that?" "Yeah, that's a tree. What's the name of this?" "That's a bench." "Okay, what's the name of this?" "That's a bush. What's the name of this?" "Oh, it's a fire engine. What's the name of this?" And you constantly are taught to direct your attention to objects in spaciousness and then label them and measure them and what color is it? You know, and fixate on the qualities of temporary objects. Everything's temporary, except is spaciousness temporary? Intrinsic spaciousness, is it changing? Is it subject to nature? The changingness of nature? How come we're not looking at that? How come we're not friends with that? That would seem to be like the prime friend to be friends with. And then objects are just like ornaments, kind of like decoration of spaciousness. Whether they come or go, that doesn't leave us without spaciousness. The storm clouds blow through. Nice decoration, but what was there before, during, and after? Spaciousness was there. Has it changed? A nice sunny day, and then the atmosphere is cloudy and rainy, and then now it's sunny now. Has the spaciousness, though, has that changed? Has that gone through alterations? Or is it just the atmosphere that went through alterations? I hope this is capturing. Where is it capturing? Doesn't say. I'll find out later. Yeah, it's good. It's all good. It's being captured in the spacious way on the hard on the external hard drive that has a massive amount of space on it. But here we say space as in memory space, which is on an object. Spaciousness we're talking about is not delineated into objects. If we say it's an object, who's the subject? Is there something outside of spaciousness? Is spaciousness divided into two? Where's the line? You know, what's drawing the line for spaciousness to be two? It's a question. These are just questions. A mosquito landed on my hand and it was getting ready to get its evening meal, and I kind of went whack like that. I said, I should have been more careful. I should have just blown it off my hand like that. So what am I doing? That's crude. Come on. I said, I hope I didn't kill it. But fortunately, I didn't. It was a little quick, so it was great. But in the future, if a mosquito lands, just go, send it on its way like that. Just like a spider. Spider somewhere, just use your breath. And unfortunately, I killed a spider. I rarely kill anything. Rarely, very rarely. This time, I was in too much of a hurry. And I tried to sweep it onto a card so I could take it outside. And my hand kind of was too crude for it. It was too delicate. And it crushed it. I felt so terrible about that. I should have just used some other card to gently, you know, but I got pressured here in Silicon Valley in too big of a hurry, which is terrible. So you start killing things when you're in too much of a hurry, right? We shouldn't be in so much of a hurry. We can't spend an extra 10 seconds helping a spider outside, to go outside. But the rush here, all the clients are just, everybody's just in this frantic hurry. And they all want things done frantically right now. And no matter how fast you do it, it's too slow. I mean, so how could you win? It's always too slow. And they say, well, go on vacation. We want it done when we come back. And so we're working Saturday. We're working Sunday. People are just working around the clock. And it's still, you know, they're never satisfied. It's never enough. Maybe objects aren't satisfying them. Maybe they feel objects are slipping away from them. Maybe they feel they're getting older. Their friends are dying. Their friends are moving away. You know, how can I keep friends? Their friends aren't really the friends they really want. And all, you know, nobody's satisfied. And they're all saying, well, we're paying you to satisfy us, and you're not satisfying us. I mean, you know, build us a new palace. It's never good enough. Right, for a little while, I kind of say, wow. But, you know, they're just, nobody's happy here. Nobody's happy. The more money you have, the more you hope you can buy it, and the more frustrated you get when you find out you can't buy it. Yeah, the rich people are very frustrated because they thought they could buy it, and they're finding out they can't. They say, what the heck do I do? what if we had a friend in spaciousness? Would we be so concerned about our house and everything else? Would that, you know, I don't care about house. It's just, I don't even think about my surroundings so much, actually. Just a blank white wall, just an old wall. I don't care, whatever. I'd probably never even vacuum, you know. If it was up to me, I wouldn't vacuum or do anything. I just don't really care, because I know it's useless. It's useless, you know. People are dusting everything all the time. I never dust. What use is it? Is it just going to get dusty again? I mean, does it make you happy? Is it clean? I mean, for how long are you happy? Then a little bit of dust on, you're unhappy again. You know. So I said, what are we doing? What are we doing? Seems to me we're all going to die unhappy. Have you ever seen anyone die happy? Maybe they're happy they're finally leaving this place. But I mean, were they really happy while they were here? Or were they just kind of tried to be content to some extent? Did they really have the friends? I mean, you know, you got a spouse and they get surgery and they get dementia. And I mean, does that make you happy? You have, you know, relatives where, you know, someone's, you know, in I got, you know, dementia, Alzheimer's, whatever. A lot of, you know, older couples, one of them gets Alzheimer's and they're locked up for like the last 15 years of their life or something, or longer. I mean, it's terrible. I mean, and it just tears their hearts out, you know. Of the other spouse just tears their hearts. Are they happy with that? Accidents killed a relative of mine. Are the family happy with that? No. So there's all this stuff happening, and people dying and getting sick and leaving disagreements in the world, right? We got disagreements now. The Pope says, a good portion of humanity is likely to die if there's a war. So, really? That's really reassuring, huh? I mean, exactly where are all these people going to die? In India, or China, Soviet Union, United States, Canada, Mexico, Central, South America, Australia? I mean, really? A good portion of humanity is likely to die if... I'm not sure exactly who these people are the Pope is saying is going to die. Unless the Pope knows something that is not telling us, right? But, I mean, that's not a very happy statement, right? To say a good portion of humanity is likely to die if the Korea and North Korea and the United States, if they start firing at each other, it's going to lead to a good portion of humanity dying? What? I don't know. That is... Why does he say stuff like that? he's not really the Pope anyway. So that's why he's saying stuff. But, who knows, right? It could be others. It could be weird circumstances, huh? But it's not a very happy outlook right now. I mean, are we all feel comfortable and secure in our friendships and our financial situation, everything, our health? You get older and where's the security you hope you would have? I don't know. I don't see too many happy people, tell you the truth. In fact, I don't see any. I see a lot of wealthy people, that's for sure. And they're very grumbly. And they're very frustrated that they haven't been able to buy happiness. And it's quite shocking to them. I see a lot, I work, around a lot of poor people, very poor people, and are they happy? They're resigned. I see, you're working with a jackhammer every day. Good luck with that. You're going to end up with all sorts of problems in your wrists and joints and body and stuff. And they say, yeah, I know that. I got a friend, he can't even get out of bed. I say, well, you're doing the same thing your friend did, right? They said, yeah. He said, oh, well, I'm young. Yeah, I said, well, after 20 years of this, you won't be able to get out of bed either. I said, what can I do? I got no choice. I don't know, is that happiness? Saying I got no choice but to suffer? And nobody seems to be friends with spaciousness that I meet. I've never met anyone in my life who's been friends with spaciousness, except the Dharma Kings. I met them internally in my mind. Ramana Maharshi was very happy, wasn't he? Why was he so happy? Maybe he was friends with spaciousness. Maybe he just decided to be friends with spaciousness. And it didn't leave him. I mean, where can spaciousness go to leave you? If it just, he gets upset, I'm leaving you. Well, where does it go to? So I'm just feeling these questions. I'm not trying to answer them. I'm just feeling them like, wow, these are interesting questions to hear. I don't need an answer, but I just enjoy looking at this question and just say, wow, that's quite a question to ask. Where can it go? How can it leave us? Where can it travel to? where it isn't already there? Can it really concentrate itself? I'm gonna go over here, all spaciousness over here. How can that happen? Where is there a greater and lesser accumulation of intrinsic spaciousness? So maybe if we can just be friends, we don't have to worry about all this spiritual stuff. Just be friends. Just sit over this body. Friends, that's all. I don't have to think about anything else. I don't have to have all this existential philosophy. We're just friends, that's all. We just get along. We just seem to have a rapport. That's all. I don't see why not. I don't see why anyone couldn't just decide that. I'm gonna be friends with spaciousness. I don't know what would be standing in the way. Is there some distance? I said, well, it's not around. You know, I don't know where to find it. What do you mean? We don't know where to find it. Where is it not? Well, I got to call it up. You know, I don't know how to text it. I don't know how to text spaciousness. Well, I don't know if we need to text it. It's right here. It's like nearer. It's present. Where is it not present? I don't think I have to text it. I don't have to get a profile update text from Facebook saying spaciousness has just updated its profile. I mean, how can it update its profile? I don't know. I don't think it's right. I don't know if it can update its profile. So maybe it's a very consistent friend. You always know what you're going to get. Very stable friend. So I've never had these kind of considerations before. It's auspicious, right? You would say this is very auspicious. So it's been an auspicious day. I don't feel so good. I feel tired. Working out every day will do that for you. Hit my weight this morning, 169.3. That's great. So this day started out great. And it's turned auspicious here. So I don't know where this will lead. I'm just kind of opening up the book. Opening up the chapter on friendship with spaciousness. And I'm open to a friendship with spaciousness. What do I got to lose? I don't have any other friendships in the vicinity, you know, that can count on. I say, hey, I'm going to take a walk with spaciousness. Come on, spaciousness, let's go take a walk. I'm walking by myself. I do everything by myself. I'm walking by myself. Oh, big bug. And It's me and the bugs, you know, out there. The birds are flying around, the bugs, and there's nobody else. And so why don't I take a walk with spaciousness? At least I have a friend, you know, that's always there as I'm walking along. You know, I'm sorry, I feel I'm going to do this. What else can I do? I don't see anything else I can do. If you have money, everybody kind of likes you, and you know, you don't have money, nobody pays any attention to you. I've noticed, I've experienced this. I kind of forced the issue with a credit card, but I wanted to see if you spend, you know, what if you're a big spender, you have money, how do people treat you? So got a credit card and started going to a store and routinely buying stuff, and you know, and my gosh, I entered the store, everybody, clerks, you know, hi, how are you today? It's great to see you. How you been? And to chat you up, you know, and like you're there, we're friends here. And then you know, couldn't spend any more. And so I go into the same store to visit my friends, and nobody even knows who I am. I can tell right away, you know, you don't have any more credit. And they don't even, like they've never seen you before in their life. I said, wait a minute. I thought we had a nice chatty, you know, friendship here. And no. No, 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 no. So when you have money, everybody's your friend. And when you don't have money, nobody's your friend. This is what I found. When you're willing to work and help out, and you have friends like that, but you know, who's your friend if you don't have any money and you can't really do much of anything for anyone? And you find out that really everything just passes you by. Are the trees your friend? Well, if it's hot and they give you shade, it seems to be that way, but are they really your friend? That's why people have dogs. But are dogs really our friend? that's why people are desperate. Are they our friend, or are they our slave? There's something, you know, and they die. There's just something. I've had a lot of animals, and you know, they die. And there's something about it which just isn't fulfilling. It just isn't. You know, people try so hard here. This is like Dog Central here, in the Silicon Valley suburbs. People pay way more attention to dogs than people here. Way more. People ignore one another here, but their dogs, I mean, the dogs are just like, you know, their spouse, you know, I mean, more than that. I mean, they just treat, pamper and treat the dogs just unbelievable. Dogs run their life because they think they have a friend. But is the dog looking at you, is it really your friend? We try to delude ourselves into that. But I found that doesn't work either. There's still this feeling of loneliness. And fear. What happens if the dog runs away, gets hit by a car, dies, gets sick, you know? Yeah, and then people like lose their dogs here. Somebody dog naps them, and I mean they just go absolutely bonkers. I'm sure pretty soon there'll be Amber Alerts for dogs. I mean the whole city has got posters up like, "Have you seen this dog?" You know, $5,000 reward. It's like somebody kidnapped their baby. I mean, it's just unbelievable. So they're distraught, completely distraught. That's not very, doesn't feel very secure. But dogs just, you know, they like that we feed them, we take them for walks and stuff. And if we don't, they just kind of look at us like guilt, lay a guilt trip on us. They're very good at laying guilt trips on us. Come on, you're not doing what I want you to do. Oh, okay, now you're my friend. You're doing what I want you to do. Okay. And just, I don't know. Does spaciousness have those kind of issues? Do we have to feed spaciousness? Does it lay a guilt trip on us? I don't know. Nobody seems to be a friend of spaciousness. I've kind of like, you kind of wonder, you come into this world and you kind of wonder, how come nobody's, you know, friends with spaciousness here? Is there must something wrong with spaciousness here? And I guess you start thinking just that since nobody's friends with spaciousness, maybe there's really, it's a dangerous thing. It's a terrible thing. Otherwise, everybody would be doing it. But Ramana Maharshi, he said, it was great. Come on in. The water's fine. It's like, well, so what are we missing here? I'm reading a book and I don't care, even the words are great, but I still feel like, well, but where's my friend? I don't have a friend. I keep saying, Jesus, I don't have a friend. And he showed up in my wife's dream last night. Jesus showed up. First time she's ever had a dream of Jesus. And there was a terrible storm. Terrible storm. She was so scared. And then she saw Jesus walking right past her, real close, and then someone behind her saying, don't worry, don't be afraid. Jesus is with us. Jesus is with us. She thought it might be St. Peter. And I had a dream of Jesus a couple of weeks ago, April 6th. He actually came up to me and put his arm around me and patted me on the shoulder, said, okay. He says, come on, let's go. It's time. You know, directly, I had a very direct meeting with Jesus. He spoke directly to me. He said, let's go. Let's go in refuge, you know, to on the sidelines here. Let's take a side trip. Get away from this situation in the world. You know, what's going on? Where apparently nobody is friends with spaciousness here. Almost no one, right? Maybe if we were friends with spaciousness, we'd all get along. We'd all be happy because we could never be abandoned. I mean, how can spaciousness abandon us? It doesn't even abandon us when we die. Or even ascend, like Padmasambhava, or be a Jesus, or be assumed, like Virgin Mary, or Elijah, or Elisha, right? We gotta have some more ascenders. Just not Jesus and Padmasambhava. Come on, let's have a few more ascenders in history. Good grief. Funny, the Christians don't know about Padmasambhava and Tibetans don't know too much about Jesus. How is that possible? But can't we all know about spaciousness? I mean, is spaciousness foreign to someone? Like in India, do they have a different kind of spaciousness than we have here? United States? Or how about down under? The Aussies? They have different, they may think they have different space down there, especially in the outback, but is the outback spaciousness really different than the spaciousness in Alaska? Yeah. Different varieties, different, you need to label the different varieties of spaciousness, intrinsic spaciousness, yeah. We've got Tibetan spaciousness here, Sri Lankan spaciousness here, and then North Korean spaciousness here. Do they have different spaciousness than North Korea? Is the intrinsic spaciousness different there? I don't know. I have to ask it. I think maybe we should start asking intrinsic spaciousness. Hey, are you like, do you hate like the intrinsic spaciousness in the United States? I mean, we better start asking ourselves these questions. What's going on? So I'll just, introduce myself to the Intrinsic Spaciousness and say, "Hey, hi. Nice to meet you. It's my pleasure. I'm really pleased to meet you." It's that simple. I don't know what else to say. Got some new walking shoes. They worked well. They're half a size too big because I had to get them discounted. What can I do? I got $70 off. I said, "I gotta get these half a size too big." I said, "Ah, well, beggars can't be choosers." And I thought they were just some cheapos, but it turns out they were good shoes, And running shoes, Brooks running shoes. They felt good, but I put them on. I said, "Wow, these feel like some quality shoes. I've never worn Brooks running shoes before." And so I'm walking in them, kind of weird because they're too big. But as they're breaking in, getting used to them, they're feeling better and better and better actually. And my feet don't hurt at all from all that walking. So they seem like good shoes. The Holy Spirit directed me to them, to these shoes, and I said, "Wow, okay, you say get them, I'll get them, even if they're half a size too big." It helps going downhill. They're really good going downhill. Uphill is a little different, but so far so good. I'm thrilled. I have a pair of walking shoes, nice pair of walking shoes, and I can even run in them. They're actually made for marathons. Long distance running, the shoes are designed for that. I don't think I'll be long distance running, but if my knee gets better, maybe I will. That would be fun too. But wherever I run to, I mean, how can I run away from intrinsic spaciousness? Or how can I run towards it? Isn't it kind of like always like by our side? I mean, if we turn around, where is it not by our side? If we turn this way, turn that way, it's, isn't it always by our side? Nice evening. First good evening in a long time. Finally, we get to a nice evening. We were patient here in California. Because we had to be, because if we didn't get the rain this winter, we were doomed. We were on the edge of doom here. I tell you, it's terrible. Droughts are terrible. It's like the third bad drought we've been through in my lifetime here in California. We go through the earthquakes, the wildfires, but the droughts, that's what really is scary. And the last one was really the scariest of them all. And we had record rain this year. All-time records in a lot of ways. Snowpack, all-time record snowpack. Saved us. So we were happy to put up with all the rain. But now, it's nice to have this kind of a balmy California evening again. That's we're going to enjoy it. But, heat, cold, but how does that affect intrinsic spaciousness? The atmosphere gets hot and cold, but intrinsic spaciousness, is it rainy? Is it changey? Does it get drought? Do we have a drought of intrinsic spaciousness? I haven't seen intrinsic spaciousness in 5 years. It hasn't been around. It's a drought. I don't know, how can we have a drought of intrinsic spaciousness? How can we have an absence or a lack of it? Say, "Well, I only got a little bit of it, I gotta get some more of it." I mean, can we have a little bit of it? I mean, is it divided like that way, like money? Yeah, I'm putting some intrinsic spaciousness away in the bank. Yeah, but I don't have that much of it. Is there a scarcity of it? How do we have a scarcity of intrinsic spaciousness? I'd like to understand that kind of thought. How is it possible to have a scarcity of it? Wow. Yeah. These are very wowish questions. It's just sort of inquiry. This is like inquiry. Ramana says, do inquiry. What kind of, we're just making inquiry. We're not trying to answer the questions, really. It's just sort of kind of self-evident, isn't it? It's kind of like waking up like, how have I been stupid or something? Or have I been misdirected my attention? I mean, how come I've never even asked this question? Can I have a scarcity of intrinsic spaciousness? I need to be worried about some sort of scarcity? We need to fight over it? I mean, you got more than I do? I need more? Is that possible? Or somebody dwelling in better intrinsic spaciousness, and I want that. I'm going to go make war on them because I want to get that, you know. They're dwelling in better intrinsic spaciousness than I'm dwelling in. Is it really? How is it better? Or how is it worse? Can it be better and worse? I don't know. Some place people say, well, the intrinsic spaciousness here is so wonderful. That's why we're all, you know, there's so many gurus here, you know. In India, the intrinsic spaciousness here is really present, you know. And especially if you come to this ashram, it's really present there, you know. and this guru, the guru has this, you know, tremendous intrinsic spaciousness. Whereas you go other places, you know, it's just not there anymore. You know, it's not the same. It's not really there. What? How is that possible? So, I mean, I got to travel to this ashram to experience intrinsic spaciousness? I don't have the money. And I want to get all those shots. And, you know, I'm not into traveling. And I'm out of luck, huh? I can't get the Rishikesh satsang, intrinsic spaciousness. I'm deprived here. I mean, how am I deprived? There's no river. Ganges is not flowing past my front door. You know, I'm deprived of. I don't have the good stuff, the good intrinsic spaciousness. I mean, do we need to take drugs to have better intrinsic spaciousness? Enhance it. We need to enhance it. Why do we need to enhance it? How can it be enhanced? So I'm just sort of, you know, pondering out loud, just pondering on this. We're just, certainly is interesting, isn't it? Kind of a little bit disquieting. Say, what's going on? What have we been feeding ourselves? What kind of, you know, pablum have we been indoctrinated into? What is this? It's like all those poor people in Africa, they don't have good intrinsic spaciousness there. What? There's a lack of intrinsic spaciousness. How's that possible? Or this, you know, this world's the only place where there is intrinsic spaciousness. It contains it. What? Huh? So what, it stops at the upper atmosphere of this planet, intrinsic spaciousness? Bug city here. They're coming in from all over the place. It's the bug bar here. They come in for a drink of light and they take off. They're searching for intrinsic spaciousness. And, gotta juice up here for a while with the light. get a hit of some light, a nice drink, stiff drink of light, and then off they go again into the darkness. I don't know where they go, but I mean, have they? Is light make intrinsic spaciousness better, and darkness makes it worse? You can't see it when it's dark. You can only see it when it's light. It's intrinsic spaciousness is it seen through the senses? Do we see it through senses like that? Is it illumined by light? And when you turn off the light, it disappears. You can't see it. Where'd it go? I thought, let's see, it's more like you need light to see objects. Turn off the light here. I'm not going to see the vitamin water bottle. But I don't think the intrinsic spaciousness disappears. I went to sleep. My friend, intrinsic spaciousness, just went to sleep. You turned off the lights and I just puts me right to sleep. But, does it need medication? I need to medicate it? Does it get depressed? I don't know. I have to tell a few some jokes then, or so it gets depressed. Do a little dance. Sing a little song. So I've been waiting for the guru to say hello to me, and the guru's never really said hello to me. And not the way that I really want. They come and go, the guru. And maybe I'm barking up the wrong tree. So, you know, why don't I just say hello to intrinsic spaciousness? At least I have a friend then, and the gurus come and go. You see Ananda Mayama in a dream, and then she doesn't show up for 2 years or whatever. I mean, right? I mean, it's like, what's that? It's misery. It's misery. I pray every night. They show up in my dream, you know, and doesn't show. Actually, she does, but she's incognito. Later, I find out, oh, that was her. Yeah. She doesn't let on that it's her. She's always playing a role in the dream. But it's a very significant role. I went to return something. There's this long, long line. And I said, man, I got to wait in this line. It's going to take forever. Oh, my gosh. I don't know if I have time to return this. It's the return line. I thought everyone's on the return line. So I need to return something, too. And then suddenly, someone said, wait a minute. Hey, that's the line to go into a movie. The return line's over here. I said, oh, really? I said, yeah. And there's nobody in that line. So, the return line. So I just walked up to this booth. Yeah, it said return's here. And there was this young, you know, teenage girl. There was very, you know, just kind of young in the booth. And, you know, kind of, you know, congenial kind of person. And I said, yeah, I'm here to make returns. And she said, oh, great, okay. I said, well, what's that line for? She said, well, they're going to a movie. They're going to a movie. It's got nothing to do with returns. They're going into a movie theater, see another movie. I said, oh, I don't want to do that. I just want to make this return. She said, okay. So I had this, like, bag or something. And I had them on my shoulder bag, and I opened it up and said, okay, now what am I returning? I said, I can't quite remember exactly what it was I was returning here. So I was looking, what am I supposed to be returning? And I said, you know, I got to apologize to you, but I don't have what I was supposed to be returning. I don't have anything to return. And then she says, oh, that's okay. It's not a problem. Just, you know, just totally relaxed and pleasant. And I kind of, then I said, well, I'm going to kind of stand over here. I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do. I thought I was going to return something, and I don't have it to return. What do I do? I don't know what to do. But she was just Didn't say anything, just relaxed, and like, no problem for her at all. And then later on, I woke up from the dream. I said, well, that had to be Sri Sri Nandamaya Ma for sure. She shows up that way. As a young, you know, maybe even like a preteen, like a 12-year-old or something like that, about 12-year-old. And I don't realize it's her until I wake up in the morning and I say, oh, that had to be the way that she acted. And what she's doing, she's reassuring. She's reassuring and saying, you don't have anything to return. You're just returning, right? Maybe I'm just returning to what? To friendship with intrinsic spaciousness. So I didn't have anything to return to, right? So what am I returning to? What is this return? I don't know. I couldn't figure it out. It wasn't anything. I said, I don't have anything to return. So she stopped, you know, stopped showing up as the guru. And she's incognito to play these roles that are like really helpful for me. Because if she shows up as a guru, I'm like, oh my gosh, you know, it's just like the greatest thing ever. But she doesn't have a spiritual ego like that. So she shows up in just this incognito, like some nondescript person just has to be walking by and say, hey, you know, do you have a ticket? Or say, okay, here's your money. Throws the money on the ground or something and walks off laughing. He said, what? That's kind of, what was that? So this happened because I accepted her as a friend, just as a friend, as a preteen friend. And ever since then, she's been showing up my dreams as a preteen friend. But I don't see her as an Anandamaya Ma, the great guru. I just as somebody, nice person, and interacting in the dream in some very significant way, like the dream sort of takes a turn that I didn't expect. It's like that. But no, I don't recognize her while I'm dreaming. She doesn't say, hey, don't you know who I am? It doesn't say that. She doesn't have a guru complex at all. That's why she's so valuable. So valuable. No guru complex. No spiritual ego at all. So I value that above everything else. You know, she doesn't say, hey, I'm, you know who I am. No. She says, it doesn't matter if you know who I am or not. I know how to help you. That's a pretty good friend right there. Maybe she is in the face of intrinsic spaciousness. Maybe she's intrinsic spaciousness with a face and a voice. As good an explanation of any, as any, isn't it? I mean, how do you explain? How do you explain her? Nobody's been able to. I mean, maybe this is, you know, a strong candidate in a face and a voice to just amass to put on intrinsic spaciousness. So maybe intrinsic spaciousness is introducing itself to me and through her in that way. Maybe it has been for the last, 20 years, but even before that, in a more subtle way. I didn't know who it was. I know somebody was in my life that, and then in retrospect, it was Sri Sri Nandamaya Ma before she ever introduced herself formally, like, you know, the guru. There was always, I realized, oh my gosh, that's the woman that's been in my life my whole life, in my dreams and in my consciousness. I always say, who is that woman with this long black hair? And you know, I was searching for her my whole life, and I finally realized, oh my gosh, that's Sri Sri Nandamaya Ma. She's been with me my entire life. But now, she doesn't appear like that long black hair, etc. She's just a you know, a 12-year-old. Just walk along the street and, you know, just come to a ticket booth and just, oh, I gave her, I bought a ticket, gave her the money, and then she gave me the change, but she threw it all on the ground like that, flung it all over the ground. I was like, and walked off kind of laughing, chatting with a friend. I said, what? Maybe she's saying the change you're looking for is everywhere. Here's your change. It's everywhere. The change is your... She flung it into space. Spaciousness, the money. Instead of handing it to me, a body, she just flung it into space, my change. Nickels, dimes, quarters, pennies, you know. I didn't get upset, I just said, whoa, what's this? Because her attitude was so, like, appropriate, I couldn't get angry at her. I just kind of didn't know what to think of it all. Maybe she's saying, yeah, the change you're looking for is a change in your relationship with the change you're looking for is spaciousness. Intrinsic spaciousness is your change. That's what you're looking for. So, again, I extol the virtues of Sri Sri Anandamayi. I can't help but do so. When I met her and became aware, really consciously aware, I immediately realized this is like the greatest friend you could ever have. You could, the perfect friend. You could not have a better friend than this. And I knew that inside of me, and I still know it. It's just that I'm not sure where she is. You know, where is this friend? I miss her. You know, I miss my friend, my perfect friend. He seems to come and go, but maybe she's saying, hey, I'm not really coming and going. Maybe I am intrinsic spaciousness. Maybe that's our true friend. Can never leave us. When she left us, she'd say, I can't leave you. People say, you're leaving. When she go, have to, you know, she's going to travel somewhere else. I say, you're leaving us. You're leaving. She goes, no, what are you talking about? There's nowhere I can go. I can't even turn around in the slightest regard. I'm everywhere. I'm everywhere and every wind. It's impossible for me to leave you. Well, who speaks like that? Obviously, she was not speaking from the standpoint of a person, was she? She said, I'm always with you. Well, what's always with us? Isn't intrinsic spaciousness always with us? It can't possibly leave us. What a face that, if it is intrinsic spaciousness, what a face it put on itself. So I'll continue, you know, the invitation, and I'll try to introduce myself to intrinsic spaciousness. Ramaharshi, same thing. They said, "Where are you going? You're dying." I'm not going. I'm not dying. I'm not going anywhere. How can I go anywhere? I'm with you always. Again, face of intrinsic spaciousness, hey, it is worth considering, isn't it? He said, the body was never me. Bhagavan was never me. I'm not Bhagavan. I'm the self. What is the self? What do you mean the self? It's everywhere. Well, what's everywhere? Intrinsic spaciousness is everywhere, isn't it? So, you know, I'm desperate. I need help. So I'm willing to dig into this. I'm willing to look at it. I'm willing to consider it. I'm willing to. I'll ask her to show up tonight. You know, in my dreams and sleep. Yeah, absolutely. But I'll phrase it like intrinsic spaciousness. I'm willing to see your face. You know, show a face to me so I can relate to you at least at first in that way. But it's hard to describe the experience when you meet what you realize is your perfect friend, and you know this is your perfect friend forever. That's what happened. How do you put that into words? It's just not possible. But certainly, I've been forlorn. I said, well, what happened to her? And the fact that she had died didn't make any difference with me. I said, no, she's with me, no question about it. But what is it then that doesn't die? Does intrinsic spaciousness die? Where can it go to die? What kind of change can happen to it so we say that it died? What kind of change can happen to it that we can say it was born? Or had a life? As Bougie, I think, said, I don't have a life, I am life. So, a little, toss a bone to Bougie there. He knows how to turn a phrase. The one in my dreams is Sri Sri Ananda, my mother, and Jesus too. There's no question about it. And Longchenpa. But Sri Sri Ananda, my ma, is she again has zero spiritual ego. This is a different kind of situation. Is kind of stunning to us, and so it's and of course she said, I'm not a guru at all. I'm nobody's guru. I'm not a guru. So what was she? What is she? Again, maybe she is a mask of intrinsic spaciousness. Appearing as any which way it needs to appear to say, hey, I'm here for you. I'm here for you. It's okay. You don't have to get rid of anything. I've always been here for you. I'm not a thing. You don't have to get rid of anything. What do we need to discard to make the acquaintance of intrinsic spaciousness? I mean, do I need to throw this bottle away? Isn't this bottle in intrinsic spaciousness? Isn't intrinsic spaciousness present, whether this bottle is here or anywhere else? I mean, what happens when I move the bottle? What happens to intrinsic spaciousness? Why do I need to discard something or acquire anything? I mean, what do I need to do? I don't need to do anything, do I? What is doing to intrinsic spaciousness? Is there some doing that modifies it or changes its relationship with us? Do we really need to call it life? Do we need to really call it anything? Does it really matter? Why don't we just call it friend? I call Sri Sri Anandamayi my friend. I call Jesus my friend. Jesus came back to this world. As a matter of fact, we're just about on the anniversary of that. April 30th. You'll be watching this video April 30th. That's the anniversary of Jesus returning to this world. And he says, I'm back. I've returned. I'm back. And I've come back to relate with all of you as a friend. As a friend. As a friend. Everyone as a friend. Like, who says that? Is that intrinsic spaciousness saying, you know, the mask is back here, the mask we call Jesus of intrinsic spaciousness saying, I'm here as your friend. See me as your friend. Anandamayi always said, see me as your friend. Don't see me as your mother, see me as your friend. I can't get this through to our devotees, you know, it's okay. They certainly, she said, don't see me as your mother. That's not right. You're missing the whole point of it all. See me as your friend. As they say, what a friend we have in Jesus. You know, well, what's the perfect friend? Maybe it's intrinsic spaciousness is our perfect friend. It seems like it fits the bill. We start checking off the boxes. It seems to be, the boxes seem to be being checked off here. I don't believe these Dharma kings can fail us. We just may not recognize them, how they're helping us. We expect them to come in glory and splendor and like, here comes the great guru. And that may not be the case at all. They may just be someone in some incognito in your dream and your consciousness or something that acts in a certain way that makes you kind of wonder for a moment. And so somehow shifts your attention in a certain way. Does intrinsic spaciousness only have one mask? Or is it really limited to just one mask? Or is the mask intrinsic spaciousness? Or can it just be anything at all in terms of however we need, however effective we can, you know, can relate with us? It might be saying, hey, don't forget about me. I want to be your friend. There's a saying that it's not the not us who are seeking the guru, it's the guru who is seeking us. And I believe that's very profound. I couldn't quite understand it until now. That may be the case. It may be intrinsic spaciousness is the guru, and it's seeking us, saying, "Hey, I want to be your friend. I want to be your friend." Ananda Maima says she was a beggar. She was begging us to be your friend. I'll ask her to beg some more. I'll plead with her, please come beg with me some more. I know all this walking and working I'm doing. Someday I'll be walking down a sidewalk and I'll just be like feeling like, hey, I'm king of the sidewalk. I feel pretty good here walking along the sidewalk. So you pay your dues. I've certainly been paying my dues. And at times I do feel like kind of bouncing around. It's a fun feeling. Unfortunately, I have the meniscus not so good. It means I keep it subdued. Otherwise, I might be skipping around. People might say, hey, what are you doing skipping down the sidewalk? You can't do that here. I don't know the last time I saw anyone skipping down a sidewalk. But, you'd see like a 9-year-old or something doing that, right? Skipping along. Seemed to be happy as a lark. Maybe they are still aware that intrinsic spaciousness is their friend. They haven't been told that they're supposed to relate only to objects. That hasn't quite sunk in yet. They're being schooled in it, though. Then you see them a little later on in life, they're not skipping along anymore. Kind of ponderously walking along, looking on their smartphone. Yeah. Looking for the right love object. Starts looking for love in all the wrong places. Right? The search has begun. For the right objects. Or maybe they're looking at their future homes. I wonder what my future home is going to be like. And what kind of, I got some really great ideas. And, of course, the great ideas never stop. They get the home. They say, well, it's not quite what I wanted. Let's change it this way and change it that way. Well, yeah, it'd be nice if we did this. And it'd be nice if we did this. And it'd be nice if we had this kind of car in the garage. But this over here, it never stops. And they're always thinking. Okay, how do we get this together? The financing, the right decision, the designers, the material, the workers, to synchronize everything. And I'm involved with something right now. It's the most beautiful setting I've ever seen. Really. It's just amazing. But is it making me happy? No. I gotta leave. I'm only working there. I gotta leave. And if I was there, what happens when the party is gone? You hold a party and then everyone's gone. And next morning you go out there and there's nobody there. Kind of an empty feeling. Nothing cold as ashes once the fire is gone. But isn't intrinsic spaciousness there? Wasn't it there the night before in the party? Like, hey, what a friend we have in Jesus, right? He's always there. I think maybe that's what they're referring to, huh? We assume it's inert or something, inert, but maybe it's not. We assume it's unintelligent, maybe it's not. We assume it's not a good friend, but maybe we're wrong. Maybe it's a great friend. Maybe it's our best friend. Maybe it's a perfect friend. Certainly, perfect friend that I met, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, the way she talked, the way she's referring to something, not her personality, the body, the appearance, or anything like that, but something else that's always omnipresent and is you might say formless. And that was supremely intelligent and supremely as the perfect friend. I mean, always blissful and saying exactly the right thing and doing exactly the right thing and always just, you know, perfect friend. I said, I can't believe this is the perfect friend even exists, but now I'm experiencing it directly. I said, this is amazing. We have a perfect friend. And it's not our mother. Thank God. Right? We're told that our mother is the best friend we'll ever have. And so we're trying so hard to, like, you know, make that work. And it just doesn't work for us too well, does it? Good old mom, but she's wonderful. But she just really, you know, I just wish I had a better friend. She's not the perfect friend, is she? No, she isn't. So we suffer from that because we think, well, that's as good as where we're going to get. And it's not quite good enough, is it? But keep a stiff upper lip. Carry on. Be a good soldier. Carry the banner for mom. And meanwhile, we're kind of sink into alcoholism and drug abuse and numerous marriages and affairs and stuff. And, you know, but good old mom is there, but we still have all these problems, don't we? Would we really be having all these problems if we really had a perfect friend? Would we be going to a bar, you know, just say, man, give me a drink, I just... You know, I feel forlorn and lost and abandoned and orphaned and I don't have any friends and I'm just going to try to forget about it in this bottle. I mean, would we really be doing that? Would we be, you know, screaming about war if we really had a perfect friend? If everyone had a perfect friend, would we be at each other's throats? Maybe it's a great time to make friends with intrinsic spaciousness. Might as well. What do we have to lose? You know, maybe we think we're not good enough for it. Well, why don't we ask? Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma has visited me many, 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 many times. a great many times. I wasn't good, you know, I wasn't good enough for her. Why would she be visiting me? I'm not good, you know, just like anyone else. But I'm determined and introspective and desperate. So, you know, I'm willing to entertain the possibility. Say, well, you know, hey, there's something. What is this? Let me keep pursue this. I need a friend. Basically, I need a friend. So, you know, I'm desperate for a friend. So I'm willing to really say, well, if you want to be my friend, yeah. She's like a beggar, and I don't want to turn a beggar away. I saw this beggar a couple days ago driving by. I haven't seen him for a long time. I used to give him $1 every time I drove by, and we've kind of, you know, I talk with him, he talks with me, and yeah, I treat him like I would treat my best friend, you know, basically. Why shouldn't I? I try to treat everybody that way I relate with, like they're my friend. I want to make friends. I can't make friends. So I saw him a couple of days ago, and he's back, and he looked great. And he's on the street begging, and, you know, he looks like he's managed to get some assistance, public assistance or something. And I was thinking, well, he's got nice shoes, nice clothes, and everything's fine, so why should I give him money? He said, no. I haven't seen him in a long time. I want to say hello, so let me give him $1. And then something said, I said, well, why $1? Give him two. Do I have two ones? I said, yeah, I'll give him two. Come on, it's been a while. I said, two? I said, yeah. What's $1 these days? I mean, inflation, come on. $2. What'll $2 get you? I don't know, might get you a couple hot dogs at Der Wiener Schnitzel. But hey, it's better than one. It's twice as much as one. So I gave him $2. He liked that. He liked it. And I liked it. And I said, you know what? I'm big enough to give him two. Not that I have the money, you know, that took a chunk out of my wallet, actually. $2. I don't know how much money I had, but it wasn't very much. And, you know, and he, you know, I said, how you, and then I said, how old are you? And he had 62. And I said, 60. So I got you by 2 years. He said, interesting. 2 years, two. Yeah. 222, the number of love, faith, mercy. Great number, 222. I doubled up. I said, I'm your friend. And he looked at me and he said, yeah, I'm your friend, you know. I'm homeless, maybe. Maybe he has a place to stay now. But he knew that I had given him, every time I saw him, I gave him something. And, you know, he appreciated it. He's out there hustling. He's doing better work than most beggars. Most beggars, they don't know how to beg. If you're going to be a beggar, you know, please do it well. And, you know, we'll respect that. You know, I respect it. Most just hold a sign in a place where they don't walk. I mean, when the light turns green, all the cars got to go. You go. Everyone's pushing you. I throw the money out the window. I roll it up and throw it out the window. But most people don't figure that out. I mean, you've got to walk down the line and hold a sign and smile, and, you know, and really, you know, work it, and look for the open windows. If there's a window open, now they're like, okay, go down there and, you know, get some money and, you know, work it. I think people respect it. You know, they'd say, well, you're not working. Well, begging is work. If you really work at begging, it's work. It's work. And I respect beggars because it gives us opportunity to meet somebody we wouldn't have met otherwise. And they're more sociable than most people you meet in the Silicon Valley in the first place. They actually say hello and they say, God bless. When do you? I mean, the only time I ever hear God bless is when I give a beggar some money. I don't know if they're homeless, or some of them not homeless. They're just begging, all right? And people say, well, you know, those beggars, they can make more money than most. Come on, yeah. I mean, the media is always exposing them, like, yeah, they make a, you know, they make a good, you know, couple hundred dollars a day. I mean, no, they don't. But so what? These people who refuse to, most people refuse to give any money at all. They're making like $200,000 a year. Most of the people in this area, at least, you know. Both spouses are working. They're pulling in a lot of money, driving super expensive cars and everything, and they're complaining about the beggars making too much money. I mean, it's unbelievable. But you know, so it's a job. Baking is a job. Work at it. And a lot of them, they don't have the intelligence. For some reason, they can't figure it out. You can't read their signs. It doesn't really matter, does it? You got a cardboard sign, you know, you want money, you want help. Who cares what the sign says? You can't say, well, I can't read your sign, so I don't know, you know, what you want. Come on, they want some dollar bills. Five, give them a five sometime, man. Hey, if I have a five, I should do that. They can have a, go get a, you know, Happy Meal at the Golden Arches. Or, I don't know. I used to carry, you know, extra food that we didn't need with me, and I just give them the food and hand them to them. Crackers, box of this, box of that. But money, you know, empowers them more in terms that they can get what they want. And you know that they're not worried about people giving them weird stuff, or you know, it just seems like a safer thing to do for them, more respectful thing to do. Yeah, if they want to buy alcohol, okay, that's their choice. But this guy is he's a good guy. I mean, he's intelligent, and like, I wonder, would intrinsic spaciousness be his friend? Why not? I mean, who is it that intrinsic spaciousness doesn't want to be friends with? I'm not sure about that. Is there somebody that intrinsic spaciousness would say, oh, no, I don't want to be friends with them? Was Sri Sri Anandamayi like that? Was she like turn up her nose and say, oh, you know, you're not good enough for me? I don't recall her ever doing that. I mean, if she's willing to be friends with me, she's willing to be friends with anybody, that's for sure. I've got every fault known to humanity, you know? I mean, but she didn't turn her nose up at me. And she keeps returning because I listened to her. I said, well, maybe, yeah. Maybe I will be your friend. So I think she thinks she's got it, you know, she's got one. She's reeling it in. It's like, yeah, why not? Why not? She's fishing for friends. I get maybe intrinsic spaciousness loves friends. So when I see this beggar, you know, asking for money, I don't see myself as any better than them at all. I just say hi, hello, and like you're just, you're working, you're present, just like I am. I'm not any better or worse, than you. I mean, it's just same, same. Hey, they might even turn their nose up at the work I do. So I'm not doing that work. It's beneath me or something. Yeah. So, I mean, they're in intrinsic spaciousness, aren't they? Dwelling in there. I mean, so same as I am. Is there some difference that that a beggar is dwelling in a different intrinsic spaciousness than I am? And if they have the exact same relationship to intrinsic spaciousness that I do, then how am I any better in that regard? I mean, wouldn't intrinsic spaciousness have the same friendship with them as it has with me? Yeah, it's a good question, isn't it? I mean, by what basis would it be different? So, this is a great way to spend an evening, isn't it? This is, you might say, it's a certain type of inquiry here. But it's organic. Because I'm a lonely teenager. I want to go back home, back where I belong. I know I'll be all right if I just stay out of sight. Lonely Teenager by Dion. Great song. Listen, take a listen to it. Lonely Teenager, Dion. I want to go home, back where I belong. Pretty auspicious to have this come up on the anniversary of Jesus returning to the world. And then my wife dreamed last night of Jesus, which is pretty much on the anniversary of his return. Yeah. And she says first time in her life she's ever dreamed Jesus ever appeared to her in a dream. There's no question we've entered auspicious times here. No question about it. And we just have to get through it. My back was killing me while I was walking today. After a certain amount of walking, this area of my back that just really hurts bad. A certain amount of exercise, yeah. And I just had to keep walking through it. It just hurt. That's all I could do. I couldn't get it to go away. But I just, kept walking. And at least my shoes work great. Super happy with that. Super happy. Maybe I'll, walk with intrinsic spaciousness. Take a walk with intrinsic spaciousness coming up. Just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking with thee. Let it be, Lord. Let it be. Wow. All right. Let it be. Intrinsic spaciousness, let it be. Oh, what a friend we have, right? Hey, make the invitation. Let's see what happens. Wow.